Show of hands here. How many people would have rather been out on the Great Bay today than doing whatever it is they did? All right, so for those of you who don't know, my name is Josh Stenton. If you live in Portsmouth, I'm one of your city councilors. And just so you know, I'll recognize the other two elected officials here right now. We have City Councilor Doug Roberts, sitting in the back of the blue shirt. And we also have State Representative Jackie Kelly Pitts sitting over by the pole. And for housekeeping measures, this is being recorded for the remainder of the City Council. There is, in fact, a meeting that's occurring right now, so they'll be able to watch this later, and some of them may filter in after that meeting ends. Two other housekeeping measures, in case of an emergency, obviously their exits. And if you've never been to the library before, the bathroom is around the corner and to the left from where you came. So a little bit about how this came about. Up until I got elected to the City Council back in 2015, my only real experiences with the Great Bay were as a UNH student. I'd hop on the bus, take it from Durham to Portsmouth, and always looked out the window to the right and said, hey, that's a really pretty body of water. And that was pretty much the extent of it for me. When I did get elected to City Council in 2015, the big issue that we were facing at the time is the wastewater treatment facility out at Pierce Island. During the campaign itself, there was a bunch of arguments going back and forth. Should be moved out to Pease, should be or stay where it currently is out at Pierce Island. And during the campaign, I honestly thought Pease made more sense. But as soon as I got elected, one of the first people who reached out to me was the Great Bay Piscataqua waterkeeper. At that time, it was Jeff Barnum. He ran into me over at Meet the Butcher Shop across the bridge in Kittery. And he's like, hey, you're Josh Stenton. I'm like, yes, I want to sit down and talk to you about the wastewater treatment facility. And I said, sure, sounds good. Sat down. And to my surprise, he said, Josh, this needs to go and remain over at Pierce Island. And that's the same exact position that the city had, is this needs to remain at Pierce Island. So we had two different experts, or two different groups of experts, looking at the same data, and they came to the same conclusion. So that was good enough for me. So from the start, being on the city council, being a good elected official, I changed my position from what I campaigned on and said, hey, this needs to remain out at Pierce Island. Now, there's a number of other decisions coming up soon that may be affecting the Great Bay, whether it be an upgrade at the Pease wastewater treatment facility, or the expansion of Lonzo, or the expansion of Red Hook, which I believe is now called Cisco. And all those decisions are going to be relied on the same data. So it made sense to me to both get the interpretations of the data from the city itself and an outside source like PREP. For those of you that are not familiar, PREP stands for, it's not up there unfortunately, so I might butcher this, the Piscataqua Regional Estuaries Partnership. Did I get that? So with all that being said, I'm going to turn it over to Rachel Rillard. And for those of you who do not know, she is the director of PREP. A little bit about her, she's initially from Keene. That's where she went to school. She went on to get her master's of public, is that me? She went on to get her master's of public administration from the Harvard's Kennedy School of Government. And after that, she went on and was appointed to run, is it LCHIP? LCHIP for, she was the initial director of LCHIP for the first two terms of it, being appointed both by Governors Lynch and then Governor Hassan. And currently, she lives in Durham, where she goes ahead and, again, is the director of PREP. And this is her second time she's gone through the State of the Estuaries report cycle. And other than that, I've been told she's an avid outdoor type. And like me, apparently, she has a dog and has a lot of experience taking the dog to run about in wetlands and such. So I'll stop there. I'll go ahead and turn it over. And thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Josh. Good evening, everybody. I have to say, I'm not big on taking my dog to wetlands. He's got a lot of hair, and so I try to keep him out of the water, but we are outside every day. It's so nice to be in Portsmouth. This is the first time we've made a public presentation as a group on any of our reports in Portsmouth, so we appreciate being invited here and for all of you turning out on such a beautiful evening, it's like summer out there, to learn a little bit more about what's going on in our estuaries and think about how it relates to some of the things going on here in Portsmouth. So, as Josh said, I'm Rachel. I've been with PREP since 2010. This is the second round that I've been through. developing a State of Our Estuaries report, which we'll talk about in a little. But I wanted to say a few things about who we are. So PREP is your national estuary program. And what that means is that we were designated here in New Hampshire, so the Great Bay and Hampton Seabrook estuaries were designated by the EPA as being estuaries of national significance. And they did that under an act that Congress established in 1987 called the National Estuaries Program. So we're one of 28 designated estuaries in the country. That's a big deal because we're only one of 28. It means we have a pretty special resource here between our Great Bay and our Hampton Seabrook estuaries. So the area that we cover, the extent of that is about 1,100 square miles. It's 52 communities. It's 42 in New Hampshire, 10 in Maine. We've got 7 tidal tributaries, and we really span from Acton, New Hampshire, and Wakefield, Acton, Maine, Wakefield, New Hampshire. I always mix those up. To the north, then we go all the way over to Candia in the west, down to parts of Kingston. We even have a little bit of Massachusetts, so you can kind of envision that area. So it's a pretty big area to cover. One of the things that makes the National Estuary Program unique is that we're non-regulatory. So we are a program of the EPA, but we're a non-regulatory program. So we've got no decision-making authority. We don't get involved in permitting, anything having to do with any regulatory decisions. Our role is to be a convener and a local resource. So we are locally driven, we're stakeholder driven, we're guided by a management committee that is here in this region and includes people from state government, local government, interested citizens, people from nonprofit organizations. So it's a 28-member committee that really guides the work that we do and ensures that we're hearing all the voices and all of the issues are being very clearly articulated and vetted and discussed amongst that group of folks. So tonight with us, we've got two of our management committee members here. We've got Jay Diener. Jay, would you want to raise your hand? So Jay is with the Seabrook Hampton Estuaries Alliance. And we have Melissa Paley, who is from Conservation Law Foundation. She's also on our management committee. And we do, from the city of Portsmouth, Peter Britz, who many of you may know, he was on our management committee for a very long time. So that's our nice little Portsmouth connection. So let me think here. I don't want to bore you too much with the ins and outs of who we are, but I'd like to introduce our staff now, and then we'll talk a little bit more about the presentation tonight. So just starting to our right, we have Abigail Lyons, and she manages our Community Technical Assistance Program. We've got Kala Matzo here. Let me just go back and say Abby's from Dover, Kala's from Kittery, Kala's our coastal scientist, and then we have Trevor Matera, who is our special projects manager, and he's from Exeter. I'm from Durham, I think Josh said that. So we're all local, and so what is this report about? Every 5 years, we develop a State of Our Estuaries report. It's something that we have to do. It's part of our agreement with EPA. So what we do is we take all of the data that gets collected over that period of time, and it's all data that's been collected and carefully gone through in terms of quality assurance. We look at that data, we analyze it, we work with our technical advisory committee and others to take a look and see what that means. Are there trends in the data or not? What is it telling us about the estuary? And we put it all together in a report. So I've forgotten to advance things here. This is us. Okay. So we do every 5 years. We track over 20 environmental, social, and management indicators that tell us about the health of our estuaries. So this last report had over 5 million data points. That's actually a conservative number. We think it's actually quite higher than 5 million, but we kind of got a little lost when we started thinking about more than 5 million. So we stopped there. The indicators are like going to the doctor. So we look at indicators of health of our estuaries. Like when you go to the doctor, indicators of your health are things like blood pressure, heart rate, weight, cholesterol, those things that the doctor measures. So those are your indicators. And if something was looking not quite right, the doctor would say, oh, geez, that cholesterol is looking pretty high. So that's what our indicators do for us when it comes to understanding the health of our our estuaries. As I mentioned, it's developed using a very collaborative peer review process we have. I mean, Kala would know better than anybody, something like over 40 people, technical advisors, people who've been involved in developing, tracking the data and doing the science on Great Bay for decades, looking at this work, making sure it's accurate and giving us their interpretation and bringing that all together. Our drafts were reviewed by over 60 members of that technical advisory committee to make sure that they were accurate, so all this has been very, very well vetted. And this is the snapshot that we want to show you that really gives you the best sense of what's going on. So it's pretty easy to see, just if you look at the colors, the red bubble looks at indicators that we're really are really having a problem. They're indicating that there's a real challenge that we've got. So eelgrass, impervious surfaces, clams, and oysters not doing well. We've lost 90% of our oyster population, for example. The blue dot is the good stuff that's going on. So those are the indicators that are either heading in the right direction or that we're really doing well. Nutrient loading point sources have come down. Beach advisory is a good. Toxic contaminants doing well. Bacteria. And the thing that you can't really see on here that I want to mention is we also have some management indicators. Land conservation is something that this region is doing very well with. We've got a goal of 20% of the land area in our 1,100 square mile region, and we are at 15.5% of the land being conserved. And if you look at the 22 communities that are coastal communities, they have conserved 19.6% of the land. So we're almost at that goal. It's a big success and something that we talk a lot about in the report. The last bubble that you see here, the yellow one, this really indicates things that we're just not sure. They might be starting to head in the wrong direction, or they've been not so good and maybe getting better, but we're not ready to put them in the blue. So you can see here that on balance, we're concerned about a lot of things, and we're not confident in saying that they're going in a good direction or a bad direction. So 12 of the 16 environmental indicators are cautionary or negative. So I will leave that there and stop with the take-home message, which is that our estuaries have declined. We know this. We have decades of data that show this, and that unfortunately they're showing signs of decreased resilience. And Kala, our coastal scientist, he's going to present next, and he's going to start with an overview of what stress and resilience is, what it means, and how we're observing what's happening in our system relative to stress and resilience. Then he's going to talk about some main indicators. We picked out ones that people are most interested in talking about, where there are lots of things happening, not the simple ones that are sort of just trending in one direction, like toxics that are consistently going down. So he's going to give you a nice sample of some important indicators. And then we're going to leave, I think, about 45 minutes for Q&A. So we want the bulk of this to be your questions for all of us and making sure that we get those questions answered. So Kala's going to talk about how to manage that. And then we're going to wrap up. After Kala, Abigail and Trevor are going to share with you a lot of the other resources that we have available to you online and on paper, and then we'll close it out. So without taking any more time, I'll introduce Kala Matso, our coastal scientist.
So my name is Kala. It's spelled K-A-L-L-E. If I walk too much, that's going to be bad. I need to stay here. So don't think about the fact that the last letter of my first name is an E, because it's pronounced like an U. In fact, what I tell people, now that I've lived in New England for 21 years, the way to pronounce my name is to think, oh, it's nice that the color of the leaves are starting to change. So that's how you pronounce my name. And the other thing I want to say right at the outset here is, that's a little concerning. This is not a doom and gloom evening. Right? I want you to know that right now. If you're disappointed and you want to go back to your car because it's not a doom and gloom evening, you can do that. But we have real concerns, but that's not doom and gloom, because a lot of people in this room, a lot of our communities, like Portsmouth, are doing a lot of fantastic things. If there's one thing to remember from this evening, we are doing good things. We can't let up. because there are a lot of things going on. There are a lot of different stressors. And in that situation, you have to be more prudent. And we can't let up. We're doing a lot of good things. So we're going to talk about resilience. You hear this word a lot. We talk about it with regard to children. Let's talk about it with regard to estuaries. The capacity of a system to absorb stress. Stress like the Mother's Day storm of 2006. Stress like pollution. Stress like invasive species. Can you absorb that stress and not get knocked off your feet? If you get knocked off your feet, can you get back up? Okay? A lot of times tonight, if you start to feel like you're getting a little bit lost, just use a simple metaphor. Think about yourself. Someone in your family has had a difficult illness. Maybe it's an illness that they never got a really good diagnosis for. Most of us are in that situation. We usually know somebody like that. What do you do in that situation? You strengthen everything you can. That's where we're at. We need to make our estuaries more resilient so that when somebody pushes on them, they don't fall down. If they do fall down, they can get back up. In some cases, we're not getting back up. I'm going to show you some of that data. We've got to fix that. This is a really nice graph. What I want you to concentrate on, first of all, is what we call the y-axis. That's the vertical axis. That's level of stress, right? If we never had invasive species, we don't have any pollution, we don't have the Mother's Day storm, we don't have sea level rise, where are we on that y-axis? Are we really high or are we really low? We're nice and low, right? And now on the x-axis, this is number of resilience features. So those are some stressors. Warming waters, population increase. Here are some resilience features. Healthy shellfish beds. Benthic communities. Benthic is just means things that are associated with the bottom, the estuary bottom. That's all benthic means, okay? Seagrass habitats, salt marshes. Those are resilience features. When all those are doing really well and they're present, where are we on the x-axis? We're way over there, right? So where do we want to be as an estuary? We want to be right there. I'm trying to shake that much. I can hold it steady if I wanted to. So that's where we want to be, right? Right in here, actually. Because when you're here and you get pushed, you don't fall down. You resist. Okay? Now, as things change, as we start to get exposed to more and more stressors, even if you have a high number of resilience features, look what happens. You do fall down, but you recover. Okay? If you have lots of disturbance events and you've lost a lot of your resilience features, now you're in this area. Recovery is not possible. Okay? This is from a paper from 2 years ago. It's based on looking at estuaries all over the world. Okay? This is where we want to be. You know, we've lost 90% of our oysters, 90% of our clams. People say somewhere between 30 and 70% of our seagrass, depending on how you measure it. Those are, as Rachel mentioned, the vital signs. Those are the most important habitats that we have. So we are having some trouble in this area along this axis. And we know we're having a lot of stress, so we're in here. Okay? We need to move ourselves this way. That's the point of this graph. Okay? If you have questions, just sort of hold on to them in your brain, because I'll be done in maybe 5-10 minutes, and we'll have lots of time for Q&A, and I can bring this graph back, and you can ask me some questions, okay? Now, our report talks about these different kinds of indicators. Pressure indicators, those are the things that are putting pressure on our system. The condition indicators are, okay, so things have been putting pressure, like nutrient loading is one of the pressures. Impervious surfaces is a pressure. So what is the effect on our estuaries? So condition indicators are things like how much eelgrass do we have? How much oysters do we have? What are the dissolved oxygen measurements? Response indicators are how are we responding? What are we trying to do about it? We're trying to restore oyster beds. We're trying to conserve land, those sorts of things. And just this last year, we added some great social indicators, such as volunteer hours and also stormwater management approaches. Now, we're doing a lot of synopsizing because we have 23 different indicators, and we don't want to hit you with too much information at once. But when you look at the pressure indicators, you see that impervious surfaces are continuing to increase. Okay, that just means pavement. Why is pavement bad? When the water hits it, it can't go through. It tends to then pool and then pulse as it pulses into the tributaries, it causes problems. We need that water to reach the tributaries more slowly. I was talking to somebody about this the other day. I said, look, if you ate a hot dog in 4 seconds, would you feel different than if you ate that hot dog in 2 minutes? And it's the same idea. When a certain volume of water hits the river super, super quickly, that is bad. That is hard on the ecosystem. If we can get that water to slow it down, we can hold on to it, we can let it infiltrate, that's easier on the ecosystem. So, condition indicators, we discussed this. Some of these really critical ones are not doing well. And as Rachel said earlier, now it seems to be working, we are doing really well on a couple of these. And the story on conservation lands and oyster restoration is mixed, and we can talk more about that later. Again, don't see an indicator you care about, read the report. I believe you all had, we're going to pass around packets later. And the report will be in there, and you can read it and then call us with questions. Have you noticed that a lot of people are moving to our area? This has been going on for a while. I am not surprised. I came here from Southern California. I don't understand why the whole world doesn't live here. This place is just beautiful. I love the people. I love the environment. I love the climate. I love everything about it. And people must be discovering that because we get more and more people, and that's a great thing. It's a great thing. There's no way you can grow and grow and grow and not have some impact on the environment. We just have to work on that, okay? So what happens when you grow? You get more impervious surfaces. When you have more impervious surfaces, the first thing that tends to happen is that your rivers start to erode more, okay? And that means you get more sediment. You get more sediment in the estuary. It's floating around. It's clouding things up in the water, and not as much sunlight is getting through. We do know that total suspended solids are going up in some sites and others not. Nutrient loading happens because we have to deal with all the human sewage, either through at the treatment plant or we deal with them with septic tanks. And nutrient loading has been going down in recent years, partly because the municipalities are doing great work of upgrading their treatment plants. The city of Portsmouth is in the middle of an upgrade. So is Exeter. Newmarket just finished an upgrade. Durham has been doing some upgrades. Dover and Rochester have not done full-on upgrades, but they have made efforts to improve their wastewater treatment processes. But most of the reason that nutrient loading has come down is because since 2010, we've had a lot of dry years. And when you have a lot of dry years, you have less non-point source pollution, okay? Most of the nutrients coming into our system are actually from non-point sources, not point sources. So now, have you noticed that this year was a little bit wetter than previous years? So we'll look at the data, but most likely you're going to see a kick up in the level of nutrients because of all the rain. So increases impervious surfaces, total suspended solids, nutrient loading has been going down, and that's a good thing. Again, we got to stay on it. We're doing well, we got to stay on it. We talked about clams down 90% since 1997. Oysters are down 90% since 1993. Those are the actual graphs. Those aren't just sort of like icons. So you can just see things are starting really high on the left, and then they go down, right? Oysters since 1993. Eelgrass since 1996 is down near 50%. Again, it depends on how you measure it. So these are really, really critical habitats. And when those things are hurting, you do get pushed down. And what you hope is that they're going to bounce back up. But when you study those graphs, what you see here, for example, oh, it's obvious to see on any of those graphs, they're not coming back up, okay? So there's two things going on here. A lot of people are like, well, what caused it? What caused it? I want to know what caused it. Who's the villain? That's one question, and it's a good question. But the other question is, why aren't things coming back? They're not always the same reason, right? You can get knocked down by one thing, but not come back and recover because of a whole lot of reasons. And that's probably what's happening in our estuary. Again, we're doing really well with regard to acres conserved. 20 of 42 communities have adopted or are adopting stormwater standards. You can see examples of those in our report. Over 26 acres of oyster restoration has been implemented, but the success is very mixed. And the main reason for that is that the main reason for that is sedimentation. We have a tremendous amount of sediment floating around in our system, a lot more than we used to have. Why? Because we used to have a lot of oysters and a lot of eelgrass, which would basically take the sediment and settle it out. It slows the water down, and when the water slows down, then the sediment falls out of suspension. We have lost so much of that habitat, that now we've got all the sediment swirling around. It lands on our oyster restoration projects and covers them up. So we're trying to adapt. We're trying to build our oyster restoration projects more vertical so that they don't get covered up by sediment. We're learning. We're getting there. Some great work that's being funded by the Nature Conservancy, and UNH is part of that, University of New Hampshire, that is. So how do we keep making progress? For PrEP, we know we have to fill in the gaps in the monitoring. Not necessarily because we don't know what to do, but because as things change, we're going to want to adjust what we're doing. And we need to continue to be able to say, oh, this must be because we're seeing more seaweed, or this must be, we're not seeing the eelgrass come back, maybe that's because this is happening. And we do have gaps in our monitoring. So we do want to track seaweed better, because we're very concerned about the seaweed situation. The benthic community, these are the bugs that live in the sediment. It's a very important component, and we don't have a really good picture of that. There's emerging contaminants. Rachel said earlier that our toxic contaminants are coming down. She's right, but those are the ones we've been tracking are those classic legacy contaminants like DDT and PCBs and PAHs and a lot of the heavy metals. But I don't know if you've been reading the newspaper, there's these new contaminants now that have been discovered, like the PFAs, which come from, all the material, the chemicals that are put on clothing and such like that to make them fire retardant and such like that. Well, we haven't been tracking those, but those are known to cause problems for humans, and they're known to cause problems to the ecosystem. So we have to do a better job of tracking that. The other thing is, you hear a lot about nutrients, but there's still a lot we don't understand. We do a good job of figuring out what's coming into the estuary, but actually, we don't do such a good job of trying to figure out what happens when the nutrients get to our estuary. How much of it goes up and turns into gas and goes right back into the atmosphere? How much of it gets buried in the sediment, which then could possibly be sort of regenerated later when you get a big storm? How much of it just gets exported out to the Atlantic? These are really important questions, and we don't actually have to many people's surprise, we don't have those answers. And they would be helpful to have. So again, the big picture. Our estuaries have declined, as has their resilience, but we're making progress. And we just have to stay on it, and you can help. How do you help? There's a lot of ways to help, and some of that information will be in your packet. Some of the ways we'd like to highlight tonight are just being very active in your town. And let your town leaders know that you care, and you want to see them continue to reduce impervious surfaces, improve stormwater management, conserve more land. There is no more effective way to protect, and it's in the long run, it's economically effective too, because
It's very expensive to engineer things or to retroactively engineer things. But when you conserve land and you provide open space so that when we get these big storms that we're going to get more and more of, the water has some place to go. We don't want to look like Houston last year, right? Just a bathtub because they have so much impervious surface. We need to continue to reduce pollution and preserve buffers. Riparian buffers mean those vegetated areas near the rivers, okay? So that's the big picture. I want to say thank you, and we do want to allow a lot of time for questions. No questions are to anything. Please ask a question that you're thinking, God, it's a stupid question. There's no stupid questions. Just ask anything, okay? That's what we're here for. We have a comfortable number of people. We have the time to do this. One of the things that we are in the midst of creating is an FAQ, frequently asked questions. These are some of the highlighted FAQs that you will see on our website very soon. So you could ask me some of these, but you maybe have other questions. This is just sort of just in case to jog the question part of your brain a little bit. And as I say, when the FAQ comes out, there's going to be about twice as many of these, and then you'll have the answers with links on the website that you can click and quickly get to resources that has more information about it. So I'm going to stop there, and Abigail, if you have a question, Abigail's going to bring a mic to you. Was that the plan? Then if you have a okay. So I'll just bring the mic to you, and we'll just do it that way. Yes, sir.
Thanks for all your great work. You talked a lot about sediment, and we have a lot of sediment. I imagine back in the day, the Great Bay was a lot deeper than it is now because of sediment coming in over time. I wonder if this sediment is, it would be helpful to dredge any of that sediment and make it deeper again, or if that would hurt. The second question I have is regarding the Seacoast Reliability Project and jet plowing. I'm wondering what that impact might be short-term and long-term on the bay.
Thank you. Okay, so the first question is about would it help to dredge? I don't have the answer, but I do know that a number of people have suggested that. I know that these projects are happening all over. Sediment management is a very, very active part of estuarine management and estuarine science. And I know there's pluses and minuses. But I know that there are a lot of people, there have been a number of scientists at UNH who have said this might be something that would really help our situation. So I think it's something that we need to look at. And it probably will get a little bit more of a look now that we published the State of Our Estuaries report in December of last year. We have the chance now to think about some more creative management interventions. I think it is going to get talked about in the next couple of the next couple of years. Other questions? Oh, jets, the second part. Okay, so so PREP is not necessarily your main go-to on this because PREP's job is to take a step back and sort of think about long-term trends and the science. And if I urge you, if you have questions about this, to talk to folks at New Hampshire DES, Department of Environmental Services. I will say that when you plow into the sediment, there is no way that you're not stirring up that sediment. And there is very likely that you are going to release those pollutants that have been in that sediment. Now, that's not only is that going to be toxic contaminants, but it's going to be nitrogen. Because there have been studies that show that there is a lot of nitrogen in our sediments. And it's inactive until it gets stirred up and reactivated, and then it can go from being organic nitrogen back to inorganic nitrogen, which is the form that plants, seaweed, and phytoplankton all take up. So there's certainly reason for concern, but again, this is not something, we are not the go-to organization for this, Okay. Thank you so much. It's working now?
We've acquired another microphone.
So we had another question back here.
Jackie Callie Pitts. I was wondering if Great Bay has been mapped in the past and mapped again. Has anyone done that? We see them mapping the ocean, and it's not a very complicated process to see just exactly how much of a buildup we have out there.
Jackie, when you say buildup of sediment. Thanks for that great question. We are very lucky to have maybe the premier ocean mapping group possibly in the world right here at UNH. There are the researchers there who are mapping not only the bathymetry, the depth of the estuary, but they're also doing more highly resolved mapping in terms of, is it mud? Is it coarser sediments? Is it fine sediments? I think their most recent map was 2014 or 2015. So we're happy to connect you with more of those resources if you'd like. But yes, it is being mapped.
And are you able to compare to see what's happening out there?
There's a lot of shifts happening. One thing that I'm very interested in is, are we seeing changes from coarser sediment size to fine? When that happens, that's usually an indication that you're getting a buildup of organic matter, because seaweed or phytoplankton over time is just degrading, and that leads to very, very, very fine sediments. And I would really like to find that information. That has not yet been synthesized from the existing maps, but I would like to look at that. So organic matter and particle size, I think we can get that data, but it hasn't yet been sort of extracted. Thanks, Jackie.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Heath Bingham, Portsmouth. Are you tracking nitrogen and runoff from the farms and homes? Do you need to, or what's the trend?
Yeah, actually, I can speak to the overall trend, but I can't speak to the trend from agriculture. I can say that in 2000, we are tracking the trend of non-point source nitrogen as well as point source. We've been tracking it since 2003. It would be really fantastic if we had that information going back to the early 80s. Unfortunately, we don't. Our data set starts in 2003. With regard to agriculture, there was a study done by Department of Environmental Services in 2014, I believe, and they estimated that agriculture was, I believe, either 8 or 13% of the non-point source load, between 8 and 13%. So fertilizer on people's lawns was around 13% of the load. Septic tanks was in the low 20s. Okay, so septic tanks is a big ticket item amongst these different non-point source issues. And those of you who don't realize it, most of the nitrogen is coming from, we're getting from our neighbors in the middle of this country. Okay, it comes over in the atmosphere and then it just comes out of it's atmospheric deposition. The nice thing about that is that because of a lot of the work to switch from, say, coal generating power plants and such like that, we are seeing that number is coming down. So that's a reason for to be happy. That number, atmospheric deposition, seems to be going down. Okay? Thank you. Yes. And then we'll go here. It's huge. Let's see. Oh, that's one of the questions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. It's very, very large. Climate change causes acidification, which you've heard about, coastal and ocean acidification. That's a real problem because it affects a lot of the creatures we care about, lobsters and crabs. One thing I didn't emphasize, but I emphasize in other talks that I give, is that sometimes folks don't appreciate how in an ecosystem. And just like, you know, sometimes, very recently I went to a physical therapist and I wanted him to fix my shoulder, and the next thing I knew he was talking about my left Achilles. And I don't know if you've had this experience, but apparently everything in your body is connected. And in that, it works the same way in an ecosystem, okay? So when you start to mess with one part of an ecosystem, other parts start to feel it too. So if we're gonna start losing our lobsters and our horseshoe crabs, or you know, certain fish at certain larval stages are being hurt by ocean acidification, that's the problem. And that affects more than just that particular species. Storm surge, sea level rise, these are also related to climate change. Warming waters, also related to climate change. More and crazy weather, right? Also related to climate change. There's research that shows that around 1995, there was a shift in the Gulf of Maine in terms of the kinds of storms we see now. We see more summer storms, we're seeing a lot more rain, and that's having a huge impact on our system, okay? But again, what I said earlier, now that doesn't mean you get to go out of here and celebrate and say, I know what the villain is, okay? There's more than one villain in this story. Also, from a management standpoint, some of these things are harder for us to address than others, right? You go to the doctor and he says, yeah, I can tell you what's going on. You're getting old, right? I actually had a doctor say that to me. He had a slight glint in his eye when he said it, because you're getting old. So I said, I can't really address getting old, right? But there are other things I can address, right? I can try to stay in shape. I can try to eat well. I can try not to stress. That's what we're in the situation of with regard to climate change. Now, if Cameron Wake, he's a UNH professor, he would say, Kala, remind everybody, we can still lower greenhouse gases emissions, and we can still change the future for the better for our grandkids and great-grandkids. So Cam, I'm saying that now. But I will say that this is something that, instead of being like, oh, well, okay, so it's not a problem with, say, nitrogen. It's because we're having warmer waters. That's why the seagrass is going away. What they're discovering in other estuaries to our south is that they're having to be more stringent about water quality and, for example, nitrogen, because of the warming waters, because these things work together. So it's complicated. Does that answer your question?
Good job.
Oh, thanks. Thanks, Wes.
I'm Wes Tater. I live in Portsmouth. I'm a champion for solving climate change. And yes, emissions have to come down. And if anybody here would like to hear about a surefire way to do that, see me afterwards, please.
Thank you. Are there other questions?
Come
to you next.
Sorry.
Melissa.
Can you sort of discuss or just describe what happens when a lot of nitrogen or other times you call it nutrients, but can you explain what happens in the ecosystem when nitrogen levels increase and why that is considered one of the primary stressors in our ecosystem?
So nitrogen is a very important thing. If you think, oh, nitrogen is sort of like the devil, nitrogen is really important. Like a lot of things that you like in your life, there's an appropriate level for it. And once you get too much of a good thing, ice cream, coffee, whatever the case may be, you get too much of it and you start to see impacts. In the case of nitrogen, what tends to happen is that species such as phytoplankton or seaweed take off and they outcompete other species such as eelgrass. Why is that bad? It's bad because seaweed and algae grow very quickly and they die very quickly. Somebody once asked me, God, everyone's always talking about algae blooms. Why don't we talk about eelgrass blooms? What's a very good question. The reason we don't talk about eelgrass blooms is because eelgrass grows slowly and it dies slowly, okay? So when you get a huge pulse of seaweed growth, that means it's gonna die, it's gonna go down to the bottom, or phytoplankton, it's gonna be consumed by microbes, And those microbes take a lot of the oxygen out of the water. When it's not consumed by microbes, it kind of just sits there as organic matter in our sediment, and it lowers the quality of our sediment. In some cases, you get a buildup of something called sulfides. That can actually even be toxic to eelgrass. We don't know if that's going on in our system. It's another piece of the puzzle we'd like to look into. So you want a balance, okay? We want phytoplankton. Phytoplankton are really important, right? This is what oysters feed on. They're a basis of our food web. We just don't want too much. We are fortunate in our system. We don't see a trend of increasing phytoplankton. There are times when we have blooms that EPA would label as indicating poor water quality, but we don't see them a lot of the time. On the other hand, we are very concerned about seaweed. And it makes sense in our system that you wouldn't see that much phytoplankton because of our huge tidal exchange. So much of that phytoplankton just gets washed out to the Atlantic. Why doesn't the seaweed get washed out? Because it's attached. See, phytoplankton just go with the current, okay? And there are a lot of estuaries that don't see phytoplankton necessarily increase. Does that mean you don't have a nutrient problem? No. You gotta look at the seaweed. And if the seaweeds are increasing, which ours are, you may have a problem. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, and the follow-up is just describe what is so important about eelgrass.
Sure. See, the other very important thing about eelgrass, and I just want to remember, and Abigail, you can help me, after Melissa, we go to this young man, and then we'll go to Josh, okay? So raise your hand if you have a lawn. Okay, do you like having a lawn? Do you like having the grass? You don't like, because you have to mow it. The thing is that the lawn and the roots, okay, if you took away the grass and the roots and then you get a little bit of a wind, you'd just be coughing all your way to your front door, right? It'd just be a dust bowl. Be like grapes of wrath, okay? The reason eelgrass is so amazing is that not only does it have these long leaves that baffle the water, slow the water down, bring the sediments out of suspension, and by the way, provide lots and lots of habitat for snails and little critters and fish to hide and all sorts of things. But they also have incredible, they're more dense and complicated under the sediment than they are above it. There's lots of things living in there. Lobsters love to burrow in there, okay? They're oxygenating the sediment. They're providing all this habitat. They're buffering our homes when we get big storms, okay? The other thing they're doing is they're taking nitrogen out of the system, which is the same thing that seaweeds and phytoplankton are doing. So there's many reasons. They're a carbon sink. They're a great storage place for carbon. There's a lot of reasons why you want eelgrass. Eelgrass does well when there isn't a lot of nitrogen in the water, because they're up in Greenland. They have basically unmeasurable amounts of nutrients in the water column, and yet the eelgrass is doing great. How is that possible? It's possible because they're getting the nutrients from the sediment with their roots. So seaweed has to get it from the water column. So if you want to advantage eelgrass over seaweed, you need to have low nutrients and high light, okay? Seaweed is much better at capturing small amounts of light. They're going to outcompete eelgrass in a high nitrogen environment. So I hope I've answered your question about why eelgrass is important. So now we want to go to this young man and then to Josh. And then we'll come back over here.
Hi there. Thank you for doing this presentation. I was curious what the biggest legacy toxins to Great Bay are.
I think the ones that continue to be the most important from a human standpoint especially would probably be mercury. Mercury is still high in some places. If you go to New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services website, there are still guidelines about eating fish in certain areas. So I would say that that is one of the more critical ones. Most of the other things are just getting buried, and because they were discontinued, like DDT, PCBs, they're just kind of going away. PAHs continue to be a problem because PAHs come from combustion and oil products. And we know that the amount of tiny little oil spills greatly outnumbers the effect of like the big things that you read about, the Valdezes and all that. We're actually getting hit by all these little minute oil spills all the time. So PAHs continue to be an issue as well.
Awesome, thank you.
Yeah. And then I see a hand back there, so we'll come over there after this gentleman. Actually, can we go to this lady first because she hasn't asked a question yet? Thanks. Josh, you're good? It's Josh's turn. Oh, I'm sorry, Abigail. I didn't mean to confuse you. I meant just before we go to...
Actually, I had two questions.
Okay.
The first one goes back to the nitrogen. When it comes to permitting a facility like the wastewater treatment plant out at Pierce Island, nitrogen levels were the biggest topic of discussion. Should that remain true, permitting levels for nitrogen regarding expansions at Lonza or the current wastewater treatment facility at Pease? And then the second unrelated question has to do with the Mother's Day flood. You're doing a great job at explaining things.
Yep.
I always scratched my head when they said this one big flood on Mother's Day came along.
Yep.
And what made that flood different than any typical flood that we see today?
Yeah. So, your first question had a touch of regulatory aspect to it, and as Rachel said, we are non-regulatory. I will say that as the organization that really likes to keep track of changes in contaminant in the effluent, and by contaminants I mean both nitrogen pollution or nutrient pollution, so that includes phosphorus as well, but also toxics, we really need to understand what's coming out. So if they're going to expand and the Pease treatment plant is going to start processing more, we're going to need to know how that changes and how that impacts the loading that goes into the system. We are going to need to know that. Taking a little bit of a step back from your question, when you read our report tonight, which I know you're all going to do before you go to bed, you will see that sort of the consensus statement from most of the scientists, and we did engage three external experts just to get some people who are like don't have a dog in the race just coming in from the outside. They basically said, look, we can't tell you how much you need to reduce nitrogen. We can tell you that you currently still do have too much nitrogen in your system. The other thing we can tell you is that you really need to pivot now and start thinking about non-point sources. You've got all these upgrades happening. And non-point source-based nutrients are the big thing that you now have to tackle. Now, are they saying Dover and Rochester don't have, they're not weighing in on that, but what they're saying is it's time to really continue to focus on non-point sources, okay? So that's the broader answer to your question. With regard to the second part of your question, the Mother's Day storm of 2006, so when these big storms come through, they can change. There's papers that show that a storm the size of Mother's Day storm can change an ecosystem for decades. That particular storm, biggest storm in our history, I believe, brought the salinity of the bay, usually even up at Adams Point, which is pretty far up, right near the getting towards the Lamprey River. The salinity is usually in the 20s up there. Okay, you might think it's getting kind of fresh in that part of the Great Bay. It's not. It's still very, very salty. After the Mother's Day storm, the salinity was less than 1 for 2 weeks. Okay, it turned it into a freshwater bathtub. Was so much rain, okay? Now, that has the potential to do a whole lot of things. It can really impact eelgrass. It can change the nutrient situation in the sediments in major ways, changing the sediment levels and dynamics. It can do a whole lot So we don't dispute, you know, that the Mother's Day storm is a huge, huge thing. Again, the point is not who's the villain, but why can't we get back up, right? Why hasn't eelgrass come back from the Mother's Day storm? 1988, almost all the eelgrass was decimated because of what's called the wasting disease. It's a parasite that kills, it's always present, okay? Some years it's worse than others, and it can come and go based on a lot of different parameters, including nutrients, okay? Temperature, salinity, lots of different things. Almost all the eelgrass in our system in the late 80s was lost to wasting disease. But then we bounced back. We bounced back to levels that were actually higher than they were before the event. Since the mid-90s and late 90s, when we get knocked down, we don't get back up. What's going on? Okay? Now, seagrass specialists will tell you that one of the ways that a seagrass bed recovers is through sexual reproduction. Seagrass reproduces both sexually and asexually. So seeds go out, they pollinate. When those seedlings start to grow, just like a little baby needs a little bit safer conditions than you and I need, and more nurturing, those seedlings need better conditions than the grown-ups to do well. So if the overall condition has gone down, those seedlings aren't gonna do as well. They're not gonna survive. We're not gonna recover. And that might be some of the reasons why we're not recovering from events like the Mother's Day storm. Okay, Josh? Yep. So then we were coming over here.
So my name is Katri Hillman. I live in Portsmouth. And this question might be a little bit harder to answer. And I hope you didn't. Well, maybe I missed it when I walked in. But I'm wondering how many of these conversations you've had or these presentations you've given in local communities and how they've possibly helped facilitate conversations with municipal decision makers.
Thank you. That's a really good question, and I don't think we know the answer. Oh, I know the first part of the answer. The first part of the question was, how many of these have you done? This is actually the first one of this size that we've done. We've done a little few meeting with a few groups and partners. What we're really excited about is that in a week's time, I believe, we are going to be putting a lot of materials and more dynamic materials on our website. So you're going to see, you're going to have the ability to see videos of me and Rachel and Abigail and Trevor talking about the different things we do and the things we're seeing in the estuary, videos and graphs. There's going to be, as I said, this FAQ, and that's going to enable us to track a little bit better, because tracking the impacts of these sorts of discussions is something that would be really hard to do. It's possible. And it's a good question, and I hope some one of my colleagues maybe writes it down as something we should think about. How do we track the impacts of an event such as tonight? Thank you very much. Other questions? Yes, sir. Oh, Abigail's coming.
Rule number one, never give a recovering politician a microphone. You might have to wrestle it away. I'm Ed Suslovic, and I came over the bridge from Maine. I was mayor and city councilor in Portland. And we were the first community in the Casco Bay watershed to enact a stormwater fee. So my question is, I suspect it might be similar. We were falling further and further behind doing the work we know we needed to do in Portland to deal with stormwater, but we didn't know how to pay for it. We didn't have property taxes go up and up, et cetera. Any thought on how the relationship of the work you all are doing may affect, sort of as a follow-up to that last question, municipalities saying, look, we know we're stressed, but are there other ways to pay for some of this really important work that maybe is a fair and equitable way to pay for it?
Abigail, would you mind taking that one? Sure. Maybe you should come over here so you can be on camera.
Okay. Thank you, Ed, for your question. So the long and the short, I think, is that communities are starting to think about some of kind of funding mechanism, potentially a stormwater utility, as a way to think about paying for some of those projects. So Carla had mentioned that non-point sources of pollution is a big problem in our region. There's 67% of the nitrogen entering our estuaries coming from those non-point sources. Some of you have probably heard about the MS4 permit, just went live this year. So I think communities are starting to get a better sense, doing a little bit of an audit of what they need to do to meet that permit, how they're meeting those requirements now with the funding that they have, identifying potential gaps, which I'm sure there will probably be gaps in funding. We, as an organization, are starting to explore that topic with communities. We're in the very beginning stages now, but stay tuned. Hopefully that answers your question.
Good evening. Thank you for everything you're doing. But I guess I really have a question of what are you doing? If you don't work on legislation, and you're not, you know, out there trying to, I know there's been a lot of evaluations from the EPA through NOAA, through some sedimentary at the mouth of the harbor. There's been a lot of, I can tell you I'm very concerned about the point sources at the Pease wastewater treatment plant and at the Pierce Island wastewater treatment plant. For years we've heard about nitrogen in our waterway, whether it's eelgrass or what. We heard the concerns of nitrogen. We've heard the concerns of runoff. So what is this organization doing to make change? And I'm missing that direct point. If you're not politically making change, if you're not financially making change, I know there are some buying of some land, but what is this organization doing? I'm kind of missing what this is all about.
So there's a concept in program planning called theory of change, and you're asking for our theory of change. I think it's a great question. I'll start it, but I might need to call on my colleagues to help me out. One part of the way we create change is by providing an objective scientific foundation to the conversation. Okay, that's really important, because if you don't have that, everyone's just going to be making different claims. Okay, and again, let's go back to the analogy of human health. When you go in to try to find out why you're not feeling well, you're going to want to know what's going on. Like what are these blood tests actually saying? Okay, so PrEP works very hard to collect that information, to make it available to people, and to interpret it. Now, social scientists have made it very clear that actually science is not the major reason why anybody makes a decision. We're far less rational than we would like to think. We make our decisions based on other things, values, who are our peers, and things like that. Another way that we can affect change is by connecting people to the information. So Abigail and Trevor are out there. They're talking with municipalities. People have questions. Towns are saying, gosh, I need to know how to write a better stormwater ordinance or a buffer regulation, and we're providing that information to them. So those are the main ways that we make change. There's a lot of other ways that our partners are making change. So we have the Nature Conservancy that is purchasing large tracts of land and doing a lot around oyster conservancy. They're making change in that way. So we're only one piece of the puzzle, and I would say we are necessary, but not sufficient. We're just one piece of the puzzle. Did you want to add to that?
Such a great question. And Kala, that was a terrific answer that covered a couple of really key components to the work that we do and the value that we provide to all of you. I know EPA is in everybody's favorite governmental entity for a lot of different reasons, but when they created the National Estuary Program, they did something really, really smart. Because we're non-regulatory, the whole purpose of our existence is to work locally with all of our stakeholders to come up with solutions before a regulatory fix is needed. And so in some ways, you could say that if regulation is needed, we've kind of not done a great job. But in some cases, it's, you know, today with the kind of population increase that you saw on one of the slides, you know, it's just inevitable that we're going to have impacts from a growing region. But one of the things that we really work hard to do is collaborate. We bring together so many different partners to have tough conversations about things, and we try to do it in a very neutral, respectful, open and transparent way. So our table is the table around which municipalities who disagree with EPA, nonprofits who are working on certain things, state agencies who have certain agendas or directives, they can all come together and we can discuss this stuff and try to figure out places that we agree where we can start to have some impact together. And that's not something that happens everywhere. And it's not something that's easily done. It takes a lot of thought, a lot of work and commitment, but it's something that we're really proud of. So I think the things that we produce, including this report, are really done in that manner. And Abigail has, one of the things that she produces is the PREPA report, so let me just back up a second. We actually have three publications that are the three legs of our NEP stool. The first one is our CCMP, which is our Comprehensive Conservation Management Plan. It's a mouthful, but it's a 10-year plan that we do in collaboration with all of our stakeholders to roadmap what actions need to take place to get to a number of agreed upon goals. And it's tough to get there and do that. We did that in 2008-09, published the second CCMP in 2010, and we've been working away, everybody has, every community, all the nonprofits, all the state agencies, been working on those 82 action plans for the past 10 years or 8 years. We are gonna be updating that plan. This State of the Estuaries report looks at the data that's collected in the field and has those indicators. So how are we doing? How are those foundational species we care about? How are those tracking? And then the third leg is the PREPA report. That's the Piscataqua Region Environmental Planning Assessment. And that looks at all of the regulations in the 52 communities and says, okay, how are towns making progress? Once they have this information, are they upgrading and are they working on having an improved stormwater ordinance? How are their buffer setbacks? What are their buffers look like? What are their setbacks look like? What are some of the building requirements? What are they doing for impervious cover? So it looks at the management response in communities. And so we take all of that information and try to find solutions, technical assistance, and give it back to the communities and decision makers to say, we know you're struggling with this issue, you know we know you're trying to get to this goal, here are some resources to help get there. So I know I said a lot of different things, but the collaboration piece, the problem solving piece, and the partnership thing is a big part of what we do. It takes a lot of our time, and we're really dedicated to doing that well. Minutes from what meeting?
So like the collaboration. You said you have a collaboration meeting with towns and communities.
Yep. Okay, we do have some meeting minutes when we have formal meetings. So we, Kala oversees the Technical Advisory Committee. So that's an open group of technical advisors who help us on all of this and give input to what we're doing with our science program. We also have this 28-member Management Committee, which I mentioned at the beginning, and there are meeting notes from We Meet Quarterly for those meetings. But a lot of these collaborations are things that are happening in smaller groups, where we might sit down and say, okay, what is a tool that's needed? How can we begin to craft a tool? And they're working groups. And there usually are meeting notes, but not minutes per se. I'm thinking of like CAW as an example. You guys have meeting notes. Do you want to talk about that as an example?
Sure. So as Rachel mentioned, PREP is really this partnership. And we not only have partners with a lot of organizations, we participated on a lot of subcommittees or groups. So two of those are the New Hampshire Coastal Adaptation Work Group, which you may have heard of as an ad hoc group working on climate adaptation and building resiliency here in the Piscataqua region. Those meetings certainly have minutes. We have full call meetings. Typically, they have a topic. We discuss. Just recently, we discussed hazard mitigation grant programs. So it's some really meaty information. Another group that I participate with is the Natural Resource Outreach Coalition. That's focused primarily on stormwater management right now, looking at the MS4 permit and trying to bring, as Rachel mentioned, some technical assistance to communities. Those also have meeting minutes available as well. So we, as Rachel said, try to be as transparent as possible. We're a stakeholder-driven group. We really want to hear from all of you, hear from our public, and try to bring resources, both financially when we can, and technical assistance to help advance protections in our region.
Just to follow up on that, I forgot your name?
James.
And did you have a question a long time ago that got ignored? Okay, so we're going to go to you next, and then we have James, and then we have, Melissa, did you have another question? Okay, you have one. So let's go to Barbara, right? Okay. So the Technical Advisory Committee meetings do have very, very in-depth notes, and they're available on our website, so I would check that out. Also, we have a meeting coming up on October 22nd from 10 to 2, and it's open to the public. So I know it's a morning, a weekday, and you might have to be at work, but if you can, please come. So let's see, we were going here, and then to Barbara, and then to James.
Has there ever been a study to determine the economic potential of the estuary system if everything were functioning in an optimal manner? And as it relates to the local situation with oyster farming and things of that nature, as well as the fact that the bay is a nursery for oceanic organisms, and so even our northeast fisheries would have some impact on the health and the economic value that would be derived via the healthy estuary.
Great question, thank you. There was a really great ecosystem services project done a couple of years ago and a report, and if you see one of us on your way out, we can connect you with that resource. It was done with a lot of partners involved, but it was led by DES. So ecosystem services is the jargon that we use to talk about what the environment gives us in terms of well-being, and sometimes that gets monetized. Like, what is it worth? And in other situations, there are non-monetary ways to rate how important environmental resources are. That's a great start. There's also a more recent project that tried to do what you're talking about, focused on riparian buffers. And we can connect you to that resource as well. Okay?
That is on our list, high up on the list, to actually build on what Kala talked about and do our own economic analysis of what our estuaries are worth. In fact, this past week, I was at a national meeting of the 28 national estuary programs, and it's one of the things that we all want to do, where we're going to be working together to develop a model or sort of a template, because you can spend years and millions of dollars doing something like this, and none of us have that kind of time and money. So we want to think very thoughtfully about how we can take some data, look at other studies that have been done, think about how we can articulate that for this particular region, because it's something that hasn't been done. A lot of times we just use tourism dollars and trying to relate that to, you know, the benefit of having clean water, and that's a place to start, but there are other values, like, you know, the aquaculture value and so on. So, and even what oysters are doing to clean the water, you know, 40 gallons a day per oyster, something like that on a good day. So anyways, it's on our list. So we're going to get to it.
Barbara?
Can you talk a little bit about how the millions of points of data are being collected? What resources are being used to get all that information?
Sure. So how are all those bits of data being collected? It's so, there's so many of them and so many different ways that it happens. So, you know, with regard to, let's just talk about some of the ones that we've talked about tonight. We've talked a lot about oysters. So we have UNH researchers who are going out and mapping where are those beds. And then we have folks from New Hampshire Fish and Game going out and actually finding out, well, how dense are the beds and what are the size of those oysters. And they are also going out and looking at how many of those oysters have disease. They send the data to us. With regard to eelgrass, there's researchers at UNH who go out and look at where is the eelgrass and what is the health of it. Actually, the last 3 or 4 years, the people who have been doing that have been contractors from the state of Maine. And they fly an airplane over the estuary, and then they go and they actually do what's called ground truthing to make sure, oh, I think that's eelgrass, but oh, it turns out it's seaweed. And so they do that, and then they give the data to us. A lot of the water quality stuff that you hear about, nutrient concentration, TSS, total suspended solids, dissolved oxygen, are all done by the Jackson Estuarine Lab at the University of New Hampshire and sent to us. And then we send it much of this to DES's Environmental Monitoring Database, which you can get, you can find on the website. It's not the most user-friendly thing, but it all goes there. So it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. Thanks for that question, Barbara. And we'll come back to you, Jackie, after James.
I want to thank you guys for a fantastic presentation today. The work that you guys are doing to try to collect all this millions of points of data and create a diagnosis for our favorite patient, the Great Bay, and hopefully advise a treatment for various people to actually act on is fantastic. You got to have a diagnosis before you can treat. Right now, the diagnosis, there's a lot of theories out there, but it's unknown. So thank you for your great work, what you're doing so far. Couple questions. First one, do you guys eat oysters? Are they safe to eat? Number two, I can imagine there's a lot of information learned from coring trees, coring glaciers. How much of our 5 million points of information and how far back can we go in history of cycles of coring the sediments that are in the Great Bay?
Great questions.
In terms of pollution and sure. Cycles.
Sure. So the oyster question is interesting. It really, I don't know if, so we all eat them and we love them. And to my knowledge, none of us have gotten sick. I go to Mexico every year and I eat so many oysters you wouldn't believe in Mexico. I still haven't gotten sick. Maybe I have a stomach of steel, I don't know. But there's a lot of safety precautions taken, just so you know. So we have a great shellfish program here, and the state of Maine also has a great shellfish program, and when they are aware of certain issues, they shut the shellfish down, right? Nothing is 100% safe, but they do a great job. They do, very recently actually, like 2 weeks ago, they did some coring of the sediment. That was done by, I think it was done by USGS, but maybe I'm, oh, NRCS, National, what does that stand for?
Natural Resource Conservation.
Which is part of the USDA, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And it's fascinating, so it goes back really far, yeah. Yeah. One thing that you see when you core all this stuff is the effect of all the sawmills that we had in the 1700s and 1800s. There's a thick layer of sawdust buried in the ground because there was so much of that happening. I can get you more information on that because Rachel?
What's that? Well, they did. They went out, as Kala said, and did some coring, and they only got to 5,000 years down. So they went below that wet aqueous soil. They went below that, and they got those core samples. So they're going to be finished with their report in December, and we're looking forward to hearing what they find. And yeah, we will. I mean, maybe you could talk about that, what we publish.
Sure. So if you go to PREP's website, we have a publications database, and it's organized. I think it is actually a very user-friendly interface. You can see everything we've published on a year-by-year basis. And I know that maybe Trevor and Abigail are going to show you a little bit of our web. I don't know if they're going to cover that, but you can get a lot of these resources. So everything that we do, we put it up because, as this lady asked before, you know, this needs to be public knowledge, so we do publicize it. So check that website. I think we got to wrap it up. Maybe we'll take one last. Was there one last question? Okay, from Jackie.
I guess my question is, I think everybody can probably hear me. I'm afraid that we will discover what's wrong with the patient at an autopsy. So we have all this data. We know that the patient is in the process of dying. But we don't know what we can do to save that patient. And I want to know, what are the action steps that, or do you recommend action steps?
Yeah, great question. I don't know that our patient is dying, you know? You look around at a lot of estuaries around around the country. I think we should be really proud of how we're doing. And the beautiful thing about our estuary, I think the thing that is the most exciting about our estuary is I don't know that it is dying. I think it's been ailing. I think it's very, very possible to bring it back. And I think we're making the right steps. Most of the communities around here are working really hard. They're working hard. They're upgrading their wastewater treatment plants. They're doing really innovative things with regard to stormwater and thinking about climate adaptation. So these are the things we can do, right? Less impervious surface, conserve land, improve stormwater management, reduce pollution, preserve buffers. We've got to keep at it until we either see a dramatic improvement or we have data that can show us exactly why we're not seeing it and when we're going to see a turnaround. The last thing I'll say on this is what I've learned in doing this for 21 years now. When I got into science, I got into science because I want to know the answer. You ask my family, like, I always need to know the answer, right? And it makes my wife crazy. But what I found out about science, especially environmental science, you usually don't get the answer. And it's frustrating to people who are expecting it. But, you know, one way to avoid a lot of frustration in life is to have the correct expectations. Science cannot tell us what to do. Science can form the basis of it. We gotta leap that gap to what we do based on our values and the democratic process. Okay? We can't tell you what to do. All we can say is our system is struggling. It has definitely lost some resilience. The way to bring it back is to keep doing those things. Okay? And we have to stay at it. All right? And I'll end there and turn it over to Abigail.
Sure, I just want to tack on before Trevor walks through some of the resources and give you a little preview of what I'm about to talk about. But one of the publications that you'll receive tonight is what we call the Municipal Guide. There's also a Citizen Guide that accompanies the report. But Jackie, within that is a very nice, handy-dandy centerfold, we like to call it. And this is just some examples of actions that communities can take. And they just build upon what Kala has mentioned already, looking at topics such as buffers and setbacks, land conservation, septic systems, and stormwater management. And there's some examples in there, and also where it's listed in other reports, because we know that communities face a lot of requests from organizations or recommendations from organizations of what to do to protect the estuary or estuaries and water quality overall. And so the good thing is that most of us are saying the same thing. And so there's an opportunity there to really get a lot of bang for our buck. Okay. Go ahead, Trevor, take it away.
Thank you. So first of all, again, I want to thank you all for coming out here. This means a lot to us. I am starting off, kicking off the end of our presentation here just to show you a little bit of the resources we have, because really when it comes down to it, we've really only scratched the surface of what this report shows and what can tell. And we just don't have the time to get into it all, so we're really gonna, this does sort of work. It doesn't work as well. I'm gonna use this one. There we go. So I'm gonna show you some of the online resources that we've proudly put up online in the last year. Let's see if I can do this. Yeah, cool. So stateofourestuaries.org is our new website that has all of these resources at your fingertips. So I'll just scroll through because it's a fantastic website, if I do say so myself. Has a lot of great stuff. So if you scroll through, you'll actually see a lot of the pressure indicators we've talked about, including some of the ones that we didn't have time to get through. At the top here, I'll just go through some of this. The big picture really talks about this. Oh, Max, there we go. I'm a PC guy, I'm sorry. Really talks about the stress and resilience that we have really been trying to impart on you tonight. So this really gives a great understanding of where we are with the stress and resilience piece of this, and it's really the message that we want to you to remember and taking it away. however, if you want to get deeper into any of the indicators, we have our full list here. So you can go to any one that really interests you, such as oysters, which we've heard about tonight. So I'll go to that one too. So we have, and this is all broken down in our paper report too. So this really follows the paper report of why it matters, the prep goals, the explanations of the indicators. You'll all be getting paper reports tonight, which Abby will go into in a bit. So those are all the indicators. We also have our reports here online, including the 2018 reports. So you can download or just look online the full report, the municipal guide, the citizens guide, which again, Abby will get into in a bit. And lastly, if I can get back to that page, two new developments that we're putting in. We'll be putting in a video series. I don't know why it's doing that. There we go. That we are currently working on. This is a really exciting piece where we've been putting a lot of work into this, filming these videos. They're really trying to be bite-sized. There's a picture of Rachel for our series introduction. I would play this right now if she, you know, would let me, but I don't think she's going to. And you can see we have a lot of videos coming up. So we've been putting a lot of work into filming these videos. So in case it's something you don't want to read from the report, if you're like, you know, reports, the words just bore me to death. These, I mean, are going to be on YouTube. They'll be here. You can link them to friends and be like, you know, I know you won't read this report about oysters, but here's like a 5-minute video that will actually give you the rundown of it. And, you know, and you can like listen to us talking like this. So in case you don't catch this presentation or your friends missed it tonight, you'd be like, you know what? I have the resources for you. And you can go to this website. So again, stateofourestuaries.org. And finally, Kali's mentioned it a couple times. We are working dynamically on an FAQ. So we've been getting a lot of these questions from people, and we've been seeing a lot of them come up pretty commonly. We can't get to everyone all the time. We really try to reach out to everyone that emails us, everyone that calls us. But if something comes up quite a bit, we're really trying to make it very accessible to you. So we are trying to gather all of these questions and put them into a frequently asked question document on our website. So this will constantly be evolving as we get your questions. We're actually reaching out to you for those questions. If you have them, please send us our way, and we will get them up here. You know, if we see that same question come up over and over again, you're like, no, this is something that people really care about. We wanted to get it up there so you guys have that knowledge. So with that, I will turn over to Abby, who will be talking about, I'm going to get back to the page, the resources that we have, and you will be getting in the paper report.
Okay, I know there's a shiny new website behind you, but in case anyone here is old school and would like a printed report, we do have some available for all of you tonight. You will receive the full report, which is all of the indicators, all 23 indicators. As Trevor mentioned, they include the why this matters, the prep goal, if there is a goal associated with that indicator, the explanation, the data that's associated with that, whether that's figures or graphs. There's some absolutely beautiful images throughout the report as well, courtesy of Emily Lord. And then also with this report, there's also the municipal guide and the citizen guide. And so those are smaller, digestible documents. They include kind of the overview or snapshot, the circle graphic or bubble graphic, as we call it, that Rachel mentioned earlier, that shows all 23 indicators. Then there's also that fold-out or centerfold piece, and that includes some of the actions. So for the municipalities, it's things like adopting a stormwater management standards in your community, or looking at increasing your buffer protections or increasing land conservation for your town. But for the citizens guide, it's more things like looking at your fertilizer application use on your property, or installing a rain garden, or donating your time or volunteering your time to be more engaged and involved in your community, or to steward the land, whether that's volunteering at a cleanup around the Great Bay Estuary or along the Atlantic coast, or stewarding a trail in your community as well. So we would love to leave you all with these tonight. On the back of the municipal guide and the citizen guide is some contact information if you have specific questions. I know it's been a lot of information, a bit of a fire hose this evening, so we're always available. I know we've said that quite a bit tonight, but we're here for you all as a resource. So if you have questions, certainly don't hesitate to reach out. And I think with that, Rachel will offer some closing remarks. Are there any questions before we do that? Terrific.
Thank you. I don't really have any closing remarks because that was perfect. As Abby said, we're here to help. We're a resource. Please don't hesitate to reach out. We're going to keep the FAQ going. It's a living, breathing thing. So the more questions we get from you, we're going to plug it in there with some answers. It's going to help people who come after you. So don't be shy. Thanks for sharing your evening with us. And we'll be around for a few minutes to answer some questions and see Abby on the way out. So thanks again. Thanks, Josh.